Jay, and it's October, so I thought I'd do a video about the history of Halloween and all of our Halloween traditions. Where did it all come from?
The formation of Halloween as we know it today is quite simplified from its origins. Actually, by the end of World War II, we'd mostly forgotten the point of where it all came from and settled into the commercial holiday of dressing up in costumes, going door to door saying trick or treat, and then receiving some sort of candy. At the end of the night, you poured your bag of candy on the floor and gleefully counted up your loot. Other parts of this holiday include Halloween-themed parties, organized haunted houses or spooky tours of graveyards. New York has a big Halloween parade every year. Adults dress up and go out to bars and enter contests for best costume prize money. I once won $200 as the Wicked Witch of the East after the house fell on her. Another time I won as the Invisible Man. As a kid, it was so much fun to go out into the night in costume with a bunch of friends and run around the neighborhood looking at everyone's jack-o'-lanterns and other spooky decorations and bringing home that haul of M&Ms, Snicker bars, and Tootsie Pops. Actually, my interest in theater began with Halloween. I loved the theater of it, especially haunted houses, which were big shows. When I was old enough to participate in them, I did, and my brother and I also staged haunted houses in our garage to give the younger kids an extra thrill. But why were we doing these Halloween things? Where does it all come from? There's an awful lot that goes into this, but to simplify, Halloween is the eve of All Hallows Day, which is meant to celebrate the spirits and the faithful dead. Yes, there are pagan and Celtic origins, but All Hallows Day is appropriated as part of the Christian liturgical year. November 1st has been All Hallows Day since 835, and most likely was picked for thematic reasons, the fall season being about leaves turning brown and dying off the trees to parallel the idea of celebrating the dead. And there are some other reasons, but this is the one that counts. Now, throughout the centuries, you get a whole host of traditions surrounding Halloween, but I'm just going to stick to the origins of what the holiday has become to us now. The ancient general belief was that the dead wandered the earth until All Saints' Day, which was their last chance to gain vengeance on their enemies, to haunt them as it were. You can see right away how the haunted house idea plays into this, and that dressing up in costumes of goblins and ghosts is representative of the dead roaming the earth. The wearing of masks is representative of disguising oneself so as not to be recognized by the ghost seeking vengeance. Organized haunted houses began in England in 1915, and they began to show up in America in the 1930s. Haunted houses as fundraisers for good causes took off in the 1970s. Trick-or-treating might begin with the lost tradition of souling. Souling was a custom of baking and sharing soul cakes for all Christian souls. Combine this with criers dressed in black, parading the streets ringing a mournful bell and calling on Christians to remember the dead. Add to this that the poor children would go door to door asking for soul cakes, and in return, the children would pray for the deceased family members of each house. While souling, the people participating would carry lanterns made out of hollowed out turnips. This leads us to the carved pumpkins, or jack-o'-lanterns. Faces carved in pumpkins are also representative of the dead souls wandering the earth. Pumpkins are an American contribution to this idea because they are native to this country and plentiful in October. Also, there is folklore concerning a man named Jack who tricked the devil into not allowing him into hell. However, when he died, the deal prevented him from being allowed to enter heaven, and so he wanders the earth, using a lit turnip carved into a lantern to guide his way. Halloween seems like a great excuse for a party, and let's face it, that's what it is, but they are also representative of what was called Dance Macabre. This was enacted at village pageants and court masks by having actors and dancers dress up as the dead and put on a kind of show that depicted what was believed to be the literal ghostly revelry going on in graveyards on Halloween night. Then, on All Hallows' Day, the spirits are led to the next world by a candlelight procession. Today, we've basically left All Hallows' Day to itself, and for most, it's become meaningless. One of the popular activities at a Halloween party is bobbing for apples. One reason is that October is apple harvest season, so there are plenty of apples on hand. All kinds of traditions regarding fire used to be important, such as this bonfire depicted in the movie Meet Me in St. Louis. When the fire dies out, this means the spirits have left to the next world. This movie takes place in 1904, and Halloween operated differently than when I was growing up. The kids are dressing up in costumes, but the bonfire is clearly an important aspect. And then there's this odd thing of the kids going from door to door, and instead of saying trick or treat, they say, "I hate you," and throw a handful of flour in their face.
I hate you, Mr. Bronco.
This means they've killed the person. In this case, the victim doesn't seem to have a choice of offering a treat. They just get the trick. I'm sure we're all very happy that this Halloween tradition has been phased out. And very purposely phased out it was, because by World War II, newspapers were running editorials about the so-called Halloween problem. There was a lot more tricks going on than treats, and so there were a variety of nationwide community efforts to keep the best of Halloween and reduce the worst of it. By the early 1950s, all kinds of popular media, radio shows, TV, movies, were playing up the kind of children's Halloween traditions we have today, and helping to take the dangerous and destructive aspects out of the holiday.
That quacking rogue is tougher than I thought.
The Puritans of America didn't celebrate All Hallows' Eve. Christmas wasn't even celebrated at first. It took the immigration of the Irish, Scottish, and Germans to bring over traditions that we now embrace. Halloween wasn't really celebrated all over the U.S. until the beginning of the 20th century, and it seems that trick-or-treating as we do it now took hold in the early 1930s. Considering that was the Great Depression, the original idea of poor children going door-to-door for a handout makes a lot of sense. Although ghostly costumes are still popular, Halloween costuming has become open season for doing anything you want. When I was a kid, I was everything from Dracula to Charlie Chaplin, a clown, Peter Pan, whatever was catching my fancy that year. We didn't think about the fact that we were supposed to be representing the dead or hiding from a vengeful spirit. In fact, growing up, I never knew why we were doing any of it. It just seemed like a lot of fun. I even considered Halloween to be my favorite holiday, with Christmas coming in as a close second.
Remember that Halloween when you were nine? Thank you.
floors creak and the tombstones quake.
Spooks come out for swing and wake.
Happy haunts materialize
and begin to vocalize. Grim pretty ghosts come out to socialize.
Well, that's your nutshell history of Halloween. Thanks for watching.